Welcome to the University of Minnesota's conference today on the future of informed consent in research and translational medicine, a century of law, ethics, and innovation. I know colleagues are still filtering in. I also want to welcome our colleagues tuning in by webcast. Thanks to all of you for joining us today. I'm Susan Wolf, chair of the university's Consortium on Law and Values in Health, Environment, and the Life Sciences, which has been the organizer for today's conference. Also, happy International Women's Day. Yes. Hence the red. Okay. So let me do some introductory work before I welcome up to the podium our first plenary speaker. The consortium, just to give you an inch of background, as many of you know, is a confederation of 20 leading centers across the University of Minnesota, collaborating to address the societal issues raised by biomedicine and the life sciences. And the issue that brings us here today, the past, the current challenges, and very much the future of informed consent couldn't be more pressing. Probably some of you saw the collection of articles last week in the New England Journal of Medicine, kicked off by an introductory article led by Christine Brady in the Clinical Bioethics Unit at NIH, just testimony to how serious these challenges are. And with the onset of e-consent and use of mobile apps in research, big data, we really need to rethink where do we go from here. And that's our goal here today. This conference is co-sponsored by the Masonic Cancer Center. And I want to give special thanks to my colleague, Dr. Doug Yee over there, who has really been an anchor in planning not just this conference, but also the one we held in December of 2015, which was such a success that it was really Doug who said, how do we keep this going? So thank you. The conference is also supported in part by the consortium's new grant from the National Human Genome Research Institute and National Cancer Institute at NIH on LawSeq, LAWSEQ, building a sound legal foundation for translating genomics into clinical application. This is a joint project that crosses Vanderbilt University and the University of Minnesota. And my colleagues, Professor Ellen Wright Clayton and Professor Francis Lorenz, are co-PIs with me for this project and have played a key role in planning today's events, together with a great faculty planning committee. Many of those planning committee members are going to be moderating today, but I'd just like to formally thank them. The list is on the website for the conference. Bruce Blazer, Kathleen Call, Mickey Eder, Gary Gardner, Apostolos Georgopoulos, Sarah Gollist, Megan Gunner, Mike Osterholm, Mike Sadowski, Jacob Tolar, John Wagner, Doug Yee, as well as Ellen Clayton and Francis Lorenz. Folks have been working on this for a long time, so we're really thrilled that you can join us. Ellen Clayton, Francis Lorenz, and I will be co-editing the written symposium that will come out of today's and tomorrow's work in the Journal of Law, Medicine, and Ethics. So let me give you a little more orientation to why this is framed as a century of work and how do we look forward. In January of 1908, so that's a bit more than a century ago, Mary Gamble Schloendorf, an elocutionist from San Francisco, was admitted to New York Hospital. Her physicians discovered an abdominal mass that would ultimately prove to be a uterine tumor. And they sought to perform an examination under ether, so this was the bad old days. Not just of surgery, but also of anesthesia. Mrs. Schloendorf consented to the ether examination, but repeatedly refused any kind of operation or an excision. And this famous story, you know where it goes. When she awoke, to her horror, she found incisions front and back, including one hip to hip across her abdomen. The surgeons had removed not only the tumor, but also her uterus and ovaries. As Paul Lombardo recounts from historical examination of the record, and I reread some of this, it's horrific, actually. Her screams and agony were so severe that, according to her own testimony, she was relegated to the hospital basement for weeks. The case, because she sued, eventually reached the highest court in New York. And there, a relatively new justice on the Court of Appeals, Justice Benjamin Cardozo, who would, of course, go on to the US Supreme Court, now writing in 1914, then, like now, it took a long time for these cases to wind their way up through the courts. Sadly, for Mrs. Schloendorf, affirmed the lower court's rejection of her claim, finding New York Hospital then protected by a doctrine that New York and other states have since rejected, a doctrine of charitable immunity, holding that hospitals like this were charities and couldn't be sued for damages. But the punchline that has stuck with us was dictum. In other words, it didn't decide the case, but it was a line that has become the most famous in all of American health jurisprudence. Justice Cardozo wrote that every human being of adult years and sound mind, what we would now call a competent patient, has a right to determine what shall be done with his own body. 1914. It would be easy to overread that. Justice Cardozo wasn't talking about what we now think of as informed consent. After all, what Mrs. Schloendorf was complaining of was surgery over refusal, not a lack of information to inform her decision. But buried in that language of rights and self-determination was the seeds of what we now think of as informed consent. As Jay Katz wrote in his classic book, The Silent World of Doctor and Patient, it would take decades before another judge, flash forward, 1957 in California, returned to this idea and began to elaborate and coin this term, informed consent. And all of that was in the clinical realm. What had happened, meanwhile, was the Nuremberg doctors' trials, where atrocities in the name of research committed by physicians in Nazi concentration camps led to judicial pronouncement of the Nuremberg Code in 1947, whose first provision required voluntary and informed consent to research. So it's now 70 years since the Nuremberg Code, and 60 since that California case, the Salgo case, coined this term informed consent. But it's safe to say that in those decades, we've discovered exactly how complicated and demanding this concept is. In fact, Professor Katz famously despaired that informed consent seemed more like some kind of fairy tale or dream rather than something real and functioning in reality. And efforts to make informed consent work in research have really only become more challenging as research has become more complicated and interdigitated with clinical care and translational medicine online. We now think about apps. It's the time to convene together for this day to figure out where we go from here. Today is day one of what's actually a two-day event, as some of you know. Today's conference is going to take a hard look, an honest look at the failures, the challenges, and the future of informed consent with scholars and practitioners from multiple disciplines. Tomorrow's conference, and I hope many of you are planning to come back for that, will be the University of Minnesota's inaugural Research Ethics Day, which is planned as an annual day devoted henceforth to thinking, talking, learning about research ethics. And tomorrow's conference in the morning will take a more practical look at what informed consent in research requires. So that's what brings us here today. Let me just do a little bit of housekeeping. The first isn't housekeeping at all. It is to tell you what I'm sure you've gleaned, that none of us would be here today, and this wouldn't be happening if not for an incredible staff who've just devoted months to setting this up. And I just want to ask you to join me in thanking, and I hope in the room and out in the lobby, you'll take a moment to thank them in person. Audrey Boyle, Catherine Grimes, Katie Loxonen, and Jackie Lee Stone from Plate Spinner Productions. Those have been our staff leaders bringing us here today. Thank you. This event is being videotaped. We're going to put the videotape up on the Consortium website in a week or two for free public access for meetings, teaching, viewing. We're also webcasting live, and we very much welcome questions from those of you on the webcast. I think you'll see the instructions, but they are to email your question to consortm, consortm at umn.edu. We have somebody standing by continuously to harvest those questions and bring them forward to the moderator. Most of what we're going to do today is going to be right here in the hall. The big exception is lunch downstairs in the Great Hall, and staff will help you get there. It's just one floor down on the escalators, and then we'll come right back up for the afternoon sessions. When we get to Q&A, you'll see there are mics. There's one there. There's one right there. Just come forward. It would be great if you could just briefly introduce yourself so we can all get to know each other. And if anybody can't get to the mic, just signal, and we have staff with handheld mics, and they can get to you. Okay. Disclosures. A summary of all the disclosures from our speakers, moderators, and planning committee. It's in your conference material. It's also out at the information desk. And the only disclosures we've received is that I have holdings in Royer Biomedical and LifeSync, and Eric Kodish has a consulting relationship with Solid GT. Continuing ed. To get continuing medical or legal credits, you need to complete the conference evaluation form that's going to be emailed to you. So you'll see there's a piece of that for continuing ed. And even if you're not getting continuing ed, we would love it if you would just take 5 minutes and fill out the form. We read every single one, and we do make adjustments depending on what you tell me, so we'd love to hear your feedback. During morning and afternoon breaks, we're going to have refreshments out in the lobby, and please use both sides of the buffet so we can do it in the allotted time and get back in here, and just ask at the information desk. Any questions, any concerns, just bring them forward. Okay. It is really a huge personal as well as professional pleasure to introduce our first speaker. We could not have a more authoritative plenary speaker to kick off this conference than Professor Alexander Morgan Capron. I'm going to do the relatively brief version of Alex's introduction because I could go on at great length. Alex is university professor, Vice Dean for Faculty and Academic Affairs, and Scott H. Bice Chair in Healthcare Law, Policy, and Ethics at the Gould School of Law, as well as Professor of Law and Medicine in the Keck School of Medicine, all at the University of Southern California. He's also co-director of the Pacific Center for Health Policy and Ethics at USC. He's an elected member of the National Academy of Medicine and the American Law Institute, a fellow and really longtime leader of the Hastings Center and the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and an honorary fellow of the American College of Legal Medicine. I mentioned Jay Katz in my introduction. Alex, who got his law degree from Yale Law School, where Jay taught for many, many years, was a student of Jay's initially, actually as was I and Ellen Clayton, and then became a collaborator with Jay, and actually wrote the foreword to the 2002 edition of The Silent World of Doctor and Patient, which I still consider kind of the Bible in thinking about the doctor-patient relationship and these problems of informed consent. Professor Capron is globally recognized as an expert in health policy, health law, and medical ethics. His many books and other publications include Ethical Issues in Governing Biobanks, Law, Science, and Medicine, and Genetics, Ethics, and Human Values. He was appointed by President Bill Clinton to the National Bioethics Advisory Commission and subsequently served as executive director of the President's Commission for the Study of Ethical Problems in Medicine and Biomedical and Behavioral Research, which issued volume after volume that's become really foundational across many domains in bioethics and health law. He's past president of the International Association of Bioethics and former director of ethics, trade, human rights, and health law at the World Health Organization, so he can bring an international perspective forward as well. Please help me in welcoming Professor Alex Capron.
That was a very sweet introduction. I appreciate it, Susan, and it's a pleasure to be here. Even though it's 82 degrees and sunny in Los Angeles today. But like you, I'm here because I want to find out more about the future of informed consent. My own task today is to talk about whence informed consent for research came, and I find at my age that people increasingly turn to me for discussions of the past, not the future. I think it was history that Susan Wolf had in mind when she contacted me. As she's already indicated, she said that this symposium would be keyed off by the landmark opinion in Schloendorf versus New York Society of New York Hospital, which was argued before the Court of Appeal 103 years ago. I think she meant to flatter me when she suggested that I was the right person to give the talk, since she gave the impression that she thought I'd been with Judge Cardozo when he handed down the decision. Although I don't go back quite that far, you'll see that I have taken seriously Susan's interest in anniversaries. So in these remarks, I will mention several consent landmarks from 1947, 1957, 1972, and 1982 that are thus having important anniversaries this year. I suppose that most of you, indeed, most people who are involved with research with human beings, whether conducting it, administering it, or reviewing it for its ethics, have for the last several years been focused on something much more current than the events that took place 35 years ago, or for that matter, 70 years ago. Indeed, if you've been considering informed consent recently, I'll bet you've been thinking about and talking about something that began in 2011 and that continues to unfold, namely the revision of what we all lovingly call the common rule. Ever since the Office for Human Research Protections, OHRP, released the advance notice of proposed rulemaking on the Common Rule 6 years ago, and then 18 months ago released a somewhat oddly titled notice of proposed rulemaking, oddly titled because it really didn't state what the rules would be, but asked 82 questions about what the rules might be, both of which prompted a tidal wave of public comments, mostly very critical. All the people concerned with the governance of human subjects have been anxiously awaiting to see how the common rule, which has been around for 25 years, might be changed. Given the chorus of complaints about many aspects of the common rule that have become even more audible over the past quarter century, I would have expected that a major redrafting of the rule would have been welcomed. But when, on the last day of the Obama administration, the revised common rule actually appeared in the Federal Register, what was generally heard around the country was a sigh of relief that most of the major changes that the OHRP had floated in the ANPRN and the NPRM hadn't actually been incorporated into the final version, which, by the way, really isn't final until the Trump White House and the Republican Congress decide whether to let the rule stand or to withdraw it, as they have many other rules promulgated in the prior administration's final months. Given the focus on the Common Rule revision process, many of you probably expect to hear a history of the origins of research-informed consent that centers on the language of the federal regulations, particularly Part 42 of the Code of Federal Regulations, Section 46.116 and 46.117. But that's not where I want to start, because if we're trying to understand the future of informed consent, we shouldn't just look at the present, but also ought instead to take our inspiration from the motto on the National Archives in Washington, D.C., "The past is prelude," and look further back into the history of experimentation with human beings and related matters to see where consent actually comes from. So let's think of informed consent for research, if you will, as a great lake connected to historical rivers. The headwaters of the first and oldest river arise from deep in the jungle of medical care, where physicians and patients encounter each other in the mysterious light that filters through the ancient trees of fear and hope and near magical powers. Traveling on this river can be difficult because its strong and swift currents often cut across each other with a rush of white water, one moment carrying our boat toward the swamp of medical paternalism, and then grounding it on an outcropping of individual autonomy. The second river begins in the city of Nuremberg, where judges bored deep into an ancient aquifer in search of the dividing line between licit experimentation with human beings and crimes against humanity. This river forks. One branch carries waters imbued with human rights straight into the lake of informed consent, while the other meanders more slowly, devolving into professional standards along the way as it picks up some of the overflow from the first river. The third river begins at a large hot spring that was first sighted in the mid-1960s by an anesthesiologist from Boston, and then became front page news in 1972 with the eruption of a geyser so huge that it darkened the sky over medical scientists and sent panic through the ranks of federal officials. The river running from this source has cooled a great deal in the past 45 years, but it still carries a whiff of sulfur. On the surface, its waters are clear, but deeper down they become turgid, and hidden currents can sometimes upend little boats called IRBs that ply its waters as they carry stacks of paper and bags of money from the many agencies and drug companies that line its banks down to the scientists who impatiently await their arrival. Since I lack permission from my IRB to challenge your sanity any further by extending this metaphor, I won't go on. But I do want to use the picture I've just sketched to explain my thesis. Simply put, I think that we, especially those like the IRB staff and members in the boats, have spent entirely too much time focused on navigating that third river. One result is that our sights have narrowed, and with them our tasks. It may be good that Greg Koski, who was a director of OHRP's predecessor, OPRR, decided to replace the adversarial relationship between OPRR and research institutions that had existed in the early 1990s, and instead put in place a culture of compliance, as he called it. But unfortunately, that has become a checklist approach to compliance that aims to ensure that every box on the list is marked off. And that in turn exposes the ironic effect of our whole research ethics structure today. It can actually divert us from attending to the basic ethical goals that were supposed to be the fonts from which everything streamed. You can see I'm sliding back into the metaphor. I'll resist. Thus, I see my task this morning as arguing that we must take a broader view of the particular ethical goal that is the topic of this symposium, namely achieving the goals of informed consent. Without doubting that we need to see whether new research topics and methods don't call for new means of seeking those goals, I hope to persuade you that we need an historical look, a trip down those other two rivers, not just the one that began in 1972 and took on particular shape with the 1974 Research Act, which mandated IRBs and with the and created the National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects of Biomedical and Behavioral Research, which issued the famous Belmont Report. We need to do all that if we want a fuller understanding of informed consent that gets beyond that one, what we can find along that one river. Moreover, especially as biomedical research comes to be integrated more closely into the everyday clinical activities of physicians, practices, and hospitals, and as more is heard about individuals having an obligation to participate in research, the role and complications of consent in the physician-patient relationship and the problems that arise when the welfare of individuals is subordinated to the good of the collectivity make clear the need for a journey along the other two rivers as well. So let's begin. Medicine has a long tradition of trying to protect patients, both through adherence to the high-minded ethical precept of always putting a patient's interest ahead of all else, especially the physician's personal interest, and through multiple stratagems that aim to induce childlike compliance with the course of action the physician regards as best suited to achieve the patient's interest. Many commentators interpret this stance as the nearly inevitable consequence of sick people being too ignorant and too anxious to participate in decision-making about medical interventions for their own good. My friend and mentor, Jay Katz, whom Susan has mentioned, argued instead that the silence at the heart of the world of doctor and patient originates with physicians' deep anxieties about their own fallibility, which are made worse rather than being relieved by the availability of ever more powerful biomedical technologies and by the educational process that makes them jealous of their hard-won authority that expertise can bring. Sharing decisions with patients would force them into an uncomfortable examination of these and related factors that they would rather not confront. For a very long time, the law did little to engage directly with such underlying issues. but it was not silent on the basic aspect of the relationship of physician and patient, namely that physicians need consent to undertake medical interventions, especially surgery. And this is no mere latter-day concept, but something well established in the law. For example, the requirement for patients' consent was stated in the Duke of York's laws in 1665, which are the founding legal documents for Massachusetts and New York. Some commentators, such as Frank Miller at NIH, have suggested that custom gave physicians a license to act without the patient's consent, at least when there was no perceived risk of physical harm. There is no question that, just like today, in your own relationship with your physician, there are many points where consent is implied rather than formally sought and formally provided. Compliance and acquiescence, that is to say, the absence of objection, are a form of consent in medicine as in the rest of our lives. But I read the history differently, both as to the need for consent and as to the interest at stake, which I believe was not and is not narrowly protection against physical harm. The heart of the informed consent requirement arose from the cause of action that patients brought when they claimed consent was absent. From the beginning, we need to recognize, however, a basic problem that the law has in framing the rights involved. And by the law here, I mean the common law, the decisions of judges. For a variety of reasons, mostly quite practical, people don't sue very often to vindicate their rights. They sue when they are injured. In the case of medical injuries, the suit is usually framed in terms of medical negligence. The law, very understandably, is protective of the difficulties faced by professionals in applying their skills and knowledge. Excellent effort is no guarantee of a good outcome when human illness, or for that matter, in the case of lawyers, a serious legal problem is involved. Proving malpractice is more difficult than establishing ordinary negligence. It requires testimony from other practitioners as to a deviation in what was done from what should have been done. Therefore, a patient plaintiff will claim that the harm he or she has suffered arose not merely from medical missteps, but because the physician defendant did something that the physician lacked permission from the patient to do. In dissecting the patient's claim in such cases, it is hardly surprising that judges give the impression that the purpose of requiring consent is for patients to act as their own gatekeeper regarding the potential harms of medical interventions. After all, the patient is in court because of the harm that he or she has suffered. But that is actually not a requirement of the law in these cases. This situation is part of the reason for the consent requirement, but more basically, the requirement embodies the precept that just as a man's home is his castle, his body is his temple, and no one, not even a priest of medicine, can enter without his consent. The common law framed cases where consent to medical interventions was absent as cases of trespass, not trespass to property, the way we use the term colloquially, which are called trespass quare clausum fregit, but a bodily trespass, trespass viet armis. A physician who provides medical care with the best of intentions may be horrified to be classified with a person who punches someone in the nose and commits a battery. But that's what an unconsented touching is. Even where no physical harm ensues, such a touching would amount to a dignitary harm, though only in the most unusual circumstances is an attorney likely to counsel a patient to bring suit for a dignitary harm. Nevertheless, the physician's failure to respect the personhood of the patient, just as an attorney would face the same issue in a case where someone has walked up to your house and a salesperson, door-to-door salesperson, and rung the doorbell, be very unwilling to bring a case of trespass there, but literally, a trespass has occurred, whether or not you have one of those little signs that say, no solicitors. Beyond the recognition that physical harm was not the only, indeed, not even the principal interest behind the requirement of consent for bodily touching, even by physicians, five other points bear emphasis as we look to the history of consent to medical care as the headwater of one of the rivers that flows into our lake of informed consent for research. The first is the language used in these cases to describe what is involved. The notion of self-determination didn't just come into bioethics and medicine when the Belmont Report, or more broadly, the early practitioners of bioethics in the late 1960s and early 1970s decided that we needed to replace medical paternalism with patient autonomy. That language about self-determination has been there a long time. For example, in Pratt versus Davis, a 1905 Illinois appellate decision, Dr. Pratt admitted he had not told Mrs. Davis that his treatment for epilepsy involved the removal of her uterus and ovaries, but insisted that, quote, when a patient places herself in the care of a surgeon for treatment without express limitations on his authority, she thereby in law consents that he may perform such operation as in his best judgment is proper and essential for her welfare. Why would a doctor say that? Because it was, at the time, the common belief. Yet in rejecting this claim, the court insisted that, quote, under a free government, at least, the free citizen's first and greatest right, which underlies all others, the right to the inviolability of his person, in other words, his right to himself, is the subject of universal acquiescence, and this right necessarily forbids a physician or surgeon, however skillful or eminent, to violate without permission the bodily integrity of his patient and to operate on him without his consent or knowledge. As you've already heard from Susan, 9 years later in Schloendorf, Judge Cardozo succinctly stated the same idea when he wrote, every human being of adult years and sound mind has a right to determine what shall be done with his own body, and a surgeon who performs an operation without his patient's consent commits an assault for which he is liable in damages. As Professor Wolf pointed out, that is, of course, mere dictum because the hospital was held not to be responsible for the actions of the surgeon, and so the ringing endorsement of bodily integrity went along with a judgment in favor of the defendant. This language at first blush suggests not a medical relationship, but a civil one. The exaltation of liberty, of what another court called thoroughgoing self-determination, sounds as though the courts thought they were protecting citizens, not from physicians, but from the state, or perhaps from mobs of their fellow citizens, rather than respecting patients' rights to make decisions about their medical care. Individual liberty is important in a democracy, and it is very wide-ranging in its effects. It is not something that others can usually waive on one's behalf. Yet, in thinking about the implications for informed consent, we also need to recognize a second point, that it began with a strong focus on each individual's physical body. So we have to ask, as these waters flow into our contemporary lake, what is the relevance of activities that are separate from that body, such as examination or manipulation of stored tissues and cells or medical records? To connect these activities with the consent requirement will require a broader examination, looking at the connection between consent to bodily interference and consent to intrusion into private matters beyond those that enjoy the protection of one's real property. That is to say, they are ones that don't necessarily lie behind the walls of one's office or home. Importantly, the interest here is not adequately captured in the relationship between consent and protecting a person from harm, including non-physical forms of harm, such as economic or reputational harms, but rather protecting them against the wrong that occurs when they are as moral agents with rights and responsibilities to chart their own lives and choose their own actions. They are not given an opportunity to decide whether or not to accept an intervention on or the use of their person or things intimately associated with their being. A third of the 5 points I want to make about these early cases is that these cases do not directly treat research as that term is now used. When they did involve experimental procedures, it was in the context of what today would be called innovative therapy, that is, departing from the usual course of treatment, typically because it wasn't working, to try something that had not yet been established as effective. Here, the early cases were quite strict in holding physicians who departed from established methods of treatment to liability for the adverse consequences of their actions. Now, up until now, the cases I've mentioned have dealt with consent or its absence, not informed consent. Information came into those earlier cases principally when the courts concluded that a patient had been a victim of false and fraudulent misrepresentation. That changed 60 years ago when the term informed consent entered the legal lexicon. A few years before that, a 55-year-old man, Martin Salgo, who appeared to be suffering from advanced arteriosclerosis and occlusion of the abdominal aorta, entered the Stanford Hospital for an imaging study and surgery. He underwent aortography, which confirmed the occlusion, but despite the surgical team's report that the procedure had been routine, the next morning Mr. Salgo awoke with paralysis of his lower extremities, which proved to be permanent. He sued the hospital and the chief surgeon, and a jury awarded $250,000 in damages. On appeal, the California Court of Appeal reversed the judgment for the plaintiff on October 22, 1957. Most of the opinion discusses the trial judge's instructions to the juror that they could find negligence based on the doctrine of res ipsa loquitur, in which negligence is inferred from the occurrence of something that does not ordinarily happen absent negligence. The appellate court pointed out that this doctrine had only recently been allowed to be used in medical malpractice cases at all, and that the judge had failed to instruct the jury about the predicate facts it would have to find in order to apply the doctrine. Since the case was being sent back to the trial court because of that error, the appellate court also addressed the plaintiff's claim that the defendant surgeon had not explained quote, that anything in the nature of aortography was to be performed, and the defendant's admission that the details of the procedure and the possible dangers therefrom were not explained. The court stated that a physician violates his duty to his patient and subjects himself to liability if he withholds any facts which are necessary to form the basis of an intelligent consent by the patient to the proposed treatment. Likewise, the physician may not minimize the known dangers of a procedure or operation in order to induce his patient's consent. Yet, having stated the duty rather strongly, the court then recognized that in placing the welfare of the patient above all else, the physician must sometimes withhold some information. So we drifted onto one of those promontories of autonomy and then slid back into the swamp of medical paternalism. But while a physician may exercise a certain amount of discretion, in the court's words, the court stated that this must be consistent with the full disclosure of the facts necessary to form an informed consent. Now, you may be interested to know that the court leaned heavily on an amicus brief filed in the case by the American College of Surgeons, from which it took the wording informed consent. So any of you in the audience who are physicians who regularly have palpitations or an elevation in your temperature when you hear the words informed consent can thank the American College of Surgeons for that. Over the subsequent years, courts struggled to figure out how a claim that a physician had failed to obtain informed consent should be treated. Was it properly treated as a claim of battery, as I've already explained? If the failure to disclose the facts necessary to a patient to reach an informed decision meant that the consent was invalid, then anything done to a patient would be unauthorized and hence a battery. Or should a failure to obtain informed consent be treated as a breach of a professional duty to be judged on the basis of expert testimony that the defendant had not made the disclosures that a reasonably competent physician would have made under the circumstances. 15 years, almost to the day after the Salgo decision, the California Supreme Court in October 1972 handed down its decision in Cobbs versus Grant. Ralph Cobbs had been hospitalized for a debilitated duodenal ulcer. His internist recommended surgery and referred him to Dr. Dudley F.P. Grant, who performed surgery. Although the ulcer disappeared, less than 2 weeks later, Mr. Cobbs underwent a splenectomy due to severe hemorrhaging from a severed artery. A month later, he was readmitted because of sharp pains, which turned out to have been caused by a gastric ulcer that he was developing. When that ulcer did not respond to medical and dietary treatment, Mr. Cobbs underwent a gastrectomy involving the removal of 50% of his stomach to reduce the production of stomach acid. Shortly after being discharged, he was rehospitalized when he began to bleed internally due to the premature absorption of a suture. After a week in the hospital, the bleeding abated sufficiently for him to be discharged and to sue the hospital and Dr. Grant for medical negligence in deciding to operate and carrying out the procedure and for a lack of informed consent. Dr. Grant admitted that he had not disclosed to the patients the risks of the various problems that actually arose, although they were all known consequences of that first surgery. Mr. Cobbs received a $45,000 judgment against the hospital, which it paid, and a general verdict against the surgeon in the amount of $23,800, which Dr. Grant appealed. The California Supreme Court reversed the latter judgment because it was not possible to know whether the jury's verdict meant that it had found a failure to obtain informed consent or had found medical negligence, which the court held would not have been a proper finding under the facts of the case because the plaintiff had not produced any expert evidence that either the decision to operate on the duodenal ulcer or the manner in which it was carried out breached the standard of care. Again, since the issue was going to go back to a trial court, the court decided to clarify the law on the subject of informed consent. First, it held that in most situations, such as the case before it, a claim of absence of informed consent should be treated as a case of negligence and not of battery. Battery would only be appropriate, it said, if a surgeon asked for consent for one thing and then did something else entirely. Yet it then went on to hold that the usual standard in malpractice cases, that the defendant had departed from what a reasonably competent physician would have done under the circumstance, was not the correct source of the standard. Instead of asking what do physicians ordinarily disclose, the relevant standard is what information would be material to a patient in making a decision about possible treatment. The Cobbs decision was one of four that year which rejected the so-called customary standard of medical practice regarding disclosure in favor of one based on the patient's need. If this were a law class, we would then go on and talk about causation and the difficulties of figuring out what information should be regarded as material. We could also confront what happened to Cobbs and the other 1972 cases, which were followed by statutes in many states, prompted by medical associations, that adopted, as a matter of statutory law, the medical custom standard. Instead, I want to close this trip down the river of informed consent in the clinical context by drawing a fifth lesson, which is how far short the doctrine of informed consent has fallen from achieving its principal objective of getting patients engaged as active informed decision makers about their medical care. Part of this problem can be laid at the feet of the courts, which have been, since the time of Schloendorf, more inclined to grand statements about patients' rights than to actually holding physicians as fellow professionals responsible for informing patients and respecting their choices. As we can see, even in the Salgo case, by the continued attachment courts have had to this concept of therapeutic privilege to withhold information. Let me turn to the second river. The story of Nuremberg and the doctor's case is familiar, I'm sure, but I want to focus on what it means that the judgment emerged, the so-called Nuremberg Code, was in the context of a criminal law response to unethical practices. I think this will point our boat as we go down the second river toward a couple of important questions, such as why, for the first 25 years after 1957, was the Nuremberg Code largely ignored by physician investigators? And does the code, with its strong commitment to voluntary informed consent, even in state-sanctioned acts, remain relevant today? The acts that the defendant in the medical case, also known as the doctor's trial, were accused of committing included many types of medical experiments, such as on typhus, malaria, epidemic jaundice, poison, high altitude conditions, and freezing and saltwater consumption. These were experiments done on concentration camp victims looking for answers of importance to the Third Reich as it carried out its war efforts, as many of these conditions affected not only the civilian, but particularly the military members of its population. The doctors were also accused of euthanasia of civilians and of killing Jews for anatomical research. There were several possible grounds for prosecuting these acts. One was as violation of the limits that had been placed on human experimentation by German law since 1900. The Germans had, in particular, under the Weimar Republic, adopted rules forbidding experimentation without consent. Those laws were not used at all, and instead, these crimes were prosecuted as violations of international law, as crimes against humanity, and some of them as genocide. The defendants raised several defenses, that they didn't do it, or that particular ones of them didn't do what they were accused of doing, they weren't part of this process, that they were following superior orders, and that they what they did was part of normal science. And I'm just going to speak about the latter. The prosecution attempted to rebut this by presenting evidence that wartime research in other countries, that is to say, principally the United States, was ethical. And so one of the prosecutors asked the following question of Dr. A.C. Ivey, an American physician who was an expert witness. Question, in order to substantially carry out your position in the American Medical Association and in the committee as appointed by Governor Green of Illinois, which was to consider the ethics of research on prisoners, because the Joliet prison in Illinois had been a site of research during the war. Did it become necessary for you to exclusively study the conditions surrounding all the other experimental programs and services in medical history in order to ably devise rules of medical ethics to be applied in the course of medical experimentation on human beings? One of those questions you couldn't possibly answer if you were trying to understand it. But the answer was, yes, I had to see what the common practices had been. So from this a line of questioning and from a document that Ivy prepared for the judges, we find the origins of the so-called Nuremberg Code. Ivy claimed to have studied the conditions under which human beings had been used as medical subjects in cultured and civilized nations throughout the world. And he then said that the principles that he had come up with had been accepted by the House of Delegates of the American Medical Association. Dr. Ivey's description of the ethical principles prevailing in the cultured and civilized nations was, however, as you can probably instantly recognize, highly inaccurate. Examples of things he overlooked were the 19th and early 20th century experiments in which patients and orphans were infected with syphilis and gonorrhea. That's what led to those Prussian and then German laws. The yellow fever research in Cuba, where the physicians stopped running it as a self-experiment, using themselves as the guinea pigs, after one of them died and instead paid large amounts of money to Spanish laborers and enlisted men. And, of course, beginning in 1932, the Tuskegee syphilis experiment in the United States, in which the subjects were kept in the dark about what was going on. Yet, after convicting most of the defendants, the court concluded, quote, the great weight of the evidence before us is to the effect that certain types of medical experiments on human beings, when kept within well-defined bounds, conform to the ethics of the medical profession generally. And then they announced the 10 elements, beginning with the voluntary consent of the human subject is absolutely essential. So why then did the river seem to come to a stop in turn without getting to the lake of informed consent? Part of this, I think, was that this was a criminal prosecution, although the rules actually originated with a physician, they appeared to come from lawyers sitting as judges. Literally interpreted, that first rule would have prohibited all pediatric and psychiatric research and a lot of other research. As biomedical research boomed after the Second War, a good deal of it driven by Cold War concerns, and as the World Medical Association came up with its Declaration of Helsinki in 1964, attention to the Nuremberg Code simply withered away. Now that we have so many other sources of rules, does anything remain from the Nuremberg Code? My own view is that the human rights underlying, the deep underlying human rights concerns reinforce, or should be seen as reinforcing, not only the common law's concern with individual wrongdoing by physicians, but also the concerns about when we act on behalf of the state for a benefit. So let me conclude with a few words about that third river, which is really going to be the concern of most of the panelists, because most of us live our lives wading into that river of the common rule. I first want to note that many people associate this process with Henry Beecher's announcement, which was 51 years ago now, in 1966, of the set of cases of unethical research in the New England Journal. And I have argued last year in a review that Beecher took a very narrow view, and from our point of view, one which remains very important in understanding the relationship between consent for research and the people who carry that research out, who are many of them drawn from biomedicine. His view was that the best protection for subjects, patients as subjects and other subjects, was a conscientious physician, not rules and regulations. It was my friend and for a while his collaborator, who Jay Katz, who pushed for the notion that we needed formal rules and a national commission to carry them out. The second conclusion that I would draw as an implication for what is in the lake of informed consent today is that we have to recognize an inheritance from the rules about informed consent that have arisen in the context of clinical care. And that is the skepticism of most patients about the purpose of those rules, which is not to inform them or even really to protect them, but rather to protect physicians and their institutions. We did a very revealing study when I directed the President's Commission back in 1979 to 83 of public opinion about informed consent. And it was overwhelmingly that it was a practice that existed entirely to defend against liability and nothing more. A third point to consider is the reluctance of many people in research to follow through with the implications of that thoroughgoing self-determination. In the article by Christine Grady that Susan mentioned in the opening, she states, she highlights the unprecedented, this is a quote, unprecedented opportunities to answer important clinical research questions available through the analysis of massive amounts of data in commercial, healthcare, research, and government databases, in social media and medical devices, and in growing collections of biological specimens and clinical and genomic data. About 8 years ago now, two of the leading lights in informed consent, Ruth Faden and Tom Beecham, Beecham being associated as one of the principal contributors to the Belmont Report, basically said, learning health systems are too important to be bogged down by informed consent. That's an overstatement, but that was basically the gist of what they had to say. Yet if you go back to 1957 or to 1972 and look at what researchers said then, it was the same thing. We are on the brink of marvelous new discoveries. We have new imaging, we have new drugs, and this informed consent process is just going to make it impossible. To which Hans Jonas famously commented that progress is an optional goal. It's not a view that has been widely adopted. It goes against the meliorist strain in our country. But it is a view which says, if at some point in searching for progress, you are willing to give up your rights, then the progress you have won is not worthwhile. So when I see people, thoughtful people, people like Alan Wertheimer and Frank Miller, writing that we really don't need informed consent. What we should ask, not whether someone understands what they're doing or why they're being asked to do it. What we need is transactional fairness. We need what an outside body like an IRB can bring to the situation. Evaluate it and do the best to protect the subject. And then, as long as there's a basic fairness in what is being asked, that's okay. That's what we need. I say that is a legitimate view, but it's only a legitimate view, in my view, if it is made explicit and if we have a public debate which says, are we prepared for these unprecedented opportunities that Christine and others write about? Are we prepared to make that exchange and put our hands not into the benevolent paternalism of physicians, but into the wise hands of IRBs? Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. We're now going to take questions. And for my staff colleagues, if we have some coming in from our online audience, just bring me file cards. So we have these mics right here, and I want to invite you to come forward. While you're thinking about that, I think I'm going to take the prerogative of the moderator and kick off.
Kick me off? Or
no, kick off the process. So Alex, has law screwed this up? You know, we those of us in law, there's a kind of critical reverence, I think. I'm speaking maybe for myself, that we bring to this story. But now we see widespread criticism of these endless consent forms, including in Christine's article. You cited the survey results that you got at the President's Commission, where people say, this isn't really about me. I don't even understand what's on the piece of paper. It's about protecting the people who are powerful and have lawyers. So has law screwed this up, and is there some lesson we should learn in law, some new direction we should go?
Yes, and yes, we do need a new direction, and law bears a big part of the blame here. And by that I mean not only legislators or judges who make the law, but unfortunately a lot of the people in the practice of law who I think give advice to their clients, or who write up the documents like the long list of all the elements of consent that appear in 46 CFR. And so what I think we need to do is say to ourselves, why did we have this rule about consent? Why did we think it had to be informed? And one of the important things I think to see is the ambivalence in the courts and their lack of clarity on this issue. What does informed mean? In the quote that I gave you from the Salgo decision, one of the quotes, the first reference was to intelligent consent. And that language appears in other documents as well. Intelligent consent refers to the person making the decision, that they are making an intelligent, thoughtful, well-informed decision, like American voters. And the other meaning of informed is the one which I actually think the court was endorsing, which is, have you been informed? Have you been told? Has a disclosure been made to you of the relevant information? Those are quite different, because the former gets us to the point of saying, well, you know, you better pass a quiz then. Now, I'm a great believer in learning processes that use questions whether it's Socratic questioning or formative assessments, quizzes, and so forth, as part of the learning process. And so I think we have examples now in the informed consent arena of people doing that, of having an iterative process which isn't aimed at testing your knowledge, but testing my failure to convey information that you find useful. And so it's a way of saying, if you're having problems with this, I've got to take another approach. My disclosures have to be more useful, because what was behind the idea of informed consent was a person making a thoughtful decision. The second thing that informed consent, I think, has done, which is on the good side if it's properly used, is making everybody in the process rehearse for themselves what it is they're asking someone to do and how well they have thought through the contingencies. If Mrs. Schloendorf doesn't get, well, she's a bad example. If Mrs. Pratt, who thought she was getting some treatment for epilepsy and found her uterus and ovaries removed, had no idea of what was going to be going on there. We would say, well, the doctor didn't even have to think how he would explain this to someone, because he wasn't going to have any conversation. But if you're going to have a conversation, well, why do you think that works? Has it been tested? Do other people do this, or are you the only one who does it? What if something bad happens to me during that process? How prepared are you to deal with that? And just a whole range of questions would have to be, you'd have to have thought through your answers to that, it seems to me. And so that process of self-scrutiny has always struck me as one of the possible benefits of informed consent. Now, I'm not sure that our present kind of checklist approach to things, or the elements checked off, induces people to do that, but potentially that's important. So I think the law has sort of misdirected doctors, made them think this is mostly about not a process of getting consent, which is a dialogue leading to a shared decision. In the research context, to me, the cardinal question above all else, and this is the one that if you don't get, you shouldn't be in the research, is that this will be research. I'll tell you a quick aside. One of the doctors I know who was doing research for the Wellcome Trust in Malawi described their determination to be very clear to people that what they were doing was research, not treatment, because as Westerners coming in, a lot of them go in and run district hospitals and things like that, so they wanted to be very clear. And because they were doing it in an area where there was a tribal language, they got the document carefully translated by a native speaker who also knew English, and the document was there. And after they'd been doing the research for about 6 months, he had a conversation with one of the people who was in the research who spoke not only her native language, but also English. And she said something along the lines of, I'm so grateful for the treatment I'm getting. And he said, did you get the consent form? And she said, oh yes, I read it and I signed it. And he says, but it says you're in research. This is not treatment, this is research. And she said, no, it doesn't say that. And so he took the form to the staff member, translated it, and said, she says it doesn't say research. And he says, oh, we don't have a word for research, so we use the word treatment. And so often we know that basic concept isn't a problem because of translation from English to something else, but it's from that setting. And if that basic question is addressed, I think everything else that's necessary will flow from it. And when it's not addressed, that doesn't happen.
Hi, I'm Pilar Osorio, and I have a question that I'm hoping you, as a person who's been sort of associated with research ethics for a long time in a variety of ways, both scholarly and very practically, might have some insights, which is, we have a lot of empirical data about what goes wrong with informed consent, how we're giving people information that maybe they don't really care about, and we're not giving them information that they do really care about, whether we're talking about the medical or the research context. But I feel like we have a lot of empirical data on what goes wrong and suggesting how we could do it better, but somehow that empirical data doesn't get incorporated into practices. So I am wondering what the barriers are to actually incorporating what we know into practice, and whether you think that the law and IRBs are part of that barrier.
Well, I think to the extent that the IRBs know that the institution is going to be tested on that checklist approach, the answer is the law and the common rule are part of the barrier. I think it goes deeper than that, though. And it really requires a lot of attention and a will to do something about it. And if you can get your research approved and you can engage in recruitment, maybe you don't really care that much. And if funding agencies, whether they're drug companies or NIH or whoever, the Gates Foundation or whoever, were to say, we think this is really important, and 15% of your grant must be spent in developing ways of communicating, it would make a big difference. We do know, I mean, there are examples of where that has been done, and it is shown to be effective. So it's not just data about failure. We have data about success, I think you were suggesting, Pilar. And so I think it's a failure of will, not just on the individual who has an easier route, but also on the institutions. Again, to me, that is taking a Hans Jonas approach, which is to say, speed is not the criterion by which we should judge success, speed in getting all the research done. I mean, his views are very appealing to me, but I don't think they're very appealing to a lot of people, and they're particularly not appealing to people who have desperate illnesses and wish there were a cure and want to see that. And a lot of research is, of course, driven by patient organizations, and as someone who has in my family several people who could benefit from various things like that, I'm eager to see it. But if confronted with that will be bought by the following costs of people really being used without understanding, and not just the physical harm, but to me, the dignitary harm of that, I would say no. I mean, there are things which are more that grease that slippery slope, and we have seen in Germany what happens when that happens, when a collective good, a good of others, is put ahead. And I don't think we're immune to it, that's all. Have I exceeded my time?
It's fine. Join me in thanking Professor Capron.